Speaking of those junctions, let's look at the diagram on the next page, because this is our next topic. We need to distinguish in between the different forms of junctional specializations that either unite adjacent cells, particularly epithelial cells, to each other or with each other, or unite the basal lamina of the underlying epithelium to the epithelial cells themselves. So as we'll see, we're going to be dealing with a number of junctional specializations. So let's review their anatomy and location now, and then we'll talk about their other additional features. First off, tight junctions or zonula occludens junctions are found only at the luminal surface of an epithelium. And they, in essence, as we'll see, serve as a barrier. They have punctate points of contact, sealing off the extracellular space between the opposed membranes, which are shown schematically in this picture. Directly below all tight junctions or zonula occlusions are zonula adherens. Zonula adherens junctions help maintain the structural integrity of the zonula occludens, and these junctions have a slight electron density in the adjacent cytoplasm of the opposed cells. The density is formed because of the interaction between the membranes at the zonula adherens and microfilaments that consist of actin. So in summary, both the tight junction, even though it's not evident on this picture, and the zonula adherens are closely associated with the microfilaments in the apical part of the cytoplasm of adjacent epithelial cells. Underlying the zonula adherens, you can see a couple examples of desmosomes. Desmosomes are junctional specializations that help keep epithelial cells together. So they're going to be particularly prominent in an epithelium that's under considerable stress, such as the stratified squamous epithelial cells that make up the epidermis. But unlike the first two junctions, desmosomes are closely linked with intermediate filaments, particularly keratin intermediate filaments in an epithelium in the adjacent cytoplasm of the joined epithelial cells. So desmosomes obviously are playing an additional role in addition to the intermediate filaments in maintaining the structural integrity of the cells they are associated with. Now, a specialized form of a desmosome is a hemidesmosome. And the job of a hemidesmosome is to keep the corresponding epithelial cell closely anchored to an underlying basement membrane or basal lamina. Lastly, gap junctions. Gap junctions promote cell-to-cell communication. And basically, they consist of a series of pores formed by connexions that are lined up between the adjacent cell membranes. But unlike the other intercellular junctions, gap junctions are not associated with any cytoskeletal element. All right, so here are the details. As we said, a zonula occludens functions as a barrier to basically the extracellular space. It helps determine cell polarity. The major components of that barrier are occludens and claudin proteins. The zonula adherens lies directly below the zonula occludens. It helps maintain the integrity and the proximity of the zonula occludens. And this is where we find cadherins linking the adjacent membranes. And as we said earlier on the previous slide, both of these junctional specializations are associated with actin microfilaments in the adjacent cytoplasm. And cadherins have tremendous pathological significance because a first step in the invasion of malignant cells through an epithelium basically results from a loss of expression of those cadherins linking the zonula occludens of adjacent cells and thereby weakening the epithelium. And next, gap junctions in no particular order are the communicating junctions. They function in cell-to-cell communication. They consist of small arrays of connexin proteins that line up and form a connexon, which is a tubular channel through which small ions such as calcium and small low molecular weight molecules such as second messengers, including cyclic AMP, may pass. And as we said earlier, gap junctions are the only junctional specialization that are not associated with any cytoskeletal element in the adjacent cytoplasm. And then desmosomes. Desmosomes, synonym for them, form spot junctions, also known as macula adherens. They help maintain the structural integrity of an epithelium by providing a mechanical link between the cells. Cadherins here as well link the adjacent membranes. And as we know, the cytoskeletal element that's closely associated with a desmosome are intermediate, usually keratin intermediate filaments in the adjacent cytoplasm. And hemidesmosomes, as we said, link epithelial cells to the underlying basement membrane, but instead of utilizing cadherins as their adjoining molecule, they utilize integrins that link hemidesmosomes to the underlying components of that basement membrane. Finally, a couple of pictures. This is a freeze fracture, one way of studying intercellular junction, and freeze fracture of a zonula occludens or a tight junction has a very distinct array of what we call sealing strands that are kind of irregularly situated, but they represent the punctate points of contact, sealing off the extracellular space by providing a closure mechanism linked by claudins and occludens at the level of those sealing strands. And finally, an electron micrograph that illustrates the locations of a couple of these junctions. And again, you can classify these junctions based on their location as well as their form and function. Note that a zonula occludens is virtually always at or near the luminal surface of an epithelium. And even though structurally it's associated with actin microfilaments in the adjacent cytoplasm, a zonula occludens in a typical electron micrograph such as this looks like an electron-dense line. And situated below a typical zonula occludens is a zonula adherence, both of which are associated with actin microfilaments. The actin microfilaments tend to be a little more prominent than the zonula occludens, giving them a slight intracellular density, electron density, on the side of the opposed membranes. Now, in this example, directly below the zonula occludens, but is a desmosome. Desmosomes can be found basically between any part of an epithelial cell, pair of epithelial cells. We happen to show this one directly below the zonula occludens. But note the significant intracellular density on either side of the adjacent membranes. Desmosomes are very easy to recognize because of the presence of this density, and the density is so prominent because, unlike the zonula occludens and the zonula adherens, the desmosome is linked to intermediate filaments in the adjacent cytoplasm. All right, last but not least, what are the luminal surface specializations that might characterize various epithelial cells? Well, fundamentally, there are three kinds of cell surface specializations, but one specialization is really a subset of another. So really, when we deal with luminal surface specializations of epithelial cells, we are talking about either microvilli or true cilia. So if I go back to the previous page for a moment, we can see that this particular micrograph shows a series of microvilli. These are luminal surface specialization that contain a core of actin microfilaments. And their job fundamentally is to increase the surface area of an absorptive epithelium. So because in this example of the presence of the glycocalyx, it's likely that these two epithelial cells are some of the lining enterocytes that are highly characteristic of much of the small and large intestine. So as we say, microvilli contain a core of actin microfilaments. Their job is to increase the absorptive area of an epithelial cell. As we just showed in the previous example, they are typical of the columnar epithelial cells of the intestine. They are characteristic of the cells in the proximal tubule of the kidney, and they're also basically found in the columnar epithelium of the respiratory system. So a specialization of microvilli are known as stereocilia. These are tall, usually branched microvilli that are found in a very restricted location, typically only found in the epithelium of parts of the male reproductive system, specifically the epididymis. So this is where they are branched. If there are unbranched stereocilia, they are characteristic typically of all of the inner ear hair cells in the vestibular and cochlear labyrinth. So stereocilia basically are simply tall microvilli. They certainly have an absorptive function, we think, in the epididymis, but they form the hairs of hair cells that basically are sensitive to fluid displacement. And when the stereocilia bend, they obviously exact changes in the underlying membrane potential of those hair cells. Lastly, how are true cilia different than microvilli? And the answer is true cilia are larger because, unlike microvilli that contain a core of actin microfilaments, true cilia contain pairs of microtubules, typically in the arrangement where there are 9 peripheral pairs of microtubules that surround a central pair of microtubules. And unlike microvilli, microtubules and the cilia that contain them are motile structures because the cilia utilize an ATPase motor molecule known as dynein to allow the microtubules to glide against one another, allowing the cilia to bend and beat on the luminal surface, particularly of respiratory epithelial cells. And as we've already pointed out, they form the core of the flagellum, the motile tail of a sperm cell. And electron micrograph on the left shows a nice comparison between the size and diameter of microvilli compared with the size and structure of a true cilium. Note that this is an epithelium probably from the respiratory system that has a combination of true cilia and microvilli because it is in part an absorptive epithelium. But note that the structure of a cilium, the size, is about 4 or 5 times greater than the size of an adjacent microvillus. But certainly when you cut them in cross-section, as in the insert at the top right of the micrograph, you can see the quite characteristic array of 9 peripheral pairs of microtubules surrounding a single central pair. And all cilia are basically are anchored into what is called a basal body, labeled B here in the apical cytoplasm. And certainly just for reference, since this is an epithelium, we see between these adjacent columnar epithelial cells an occluding junction that represents an electron-dense line, and just below that, basically a junction that's called an intermediate junction. Here, that's an old term. That's basically a zonula adherens with a more prominent density conveyed by the adjacent actin microfilaments. And then just the details of the substructure of a true cilium. Again, you see the array of microtubular peripheral pairs, 9 of them surrounding a central pair. And the key element is what we call the dynein sidearms. They contain the ATPase motor molecule dynein that conveys the motility to allow the adjacent microtubular pairs to glide against one another, conveying a motility to a true cilium. So the clinical correlate associated with true cilia is Cartagener syndrome. Basically, it renders the cilia and their microtubular pairs immotile, and if it occurs in males, it's going to render their sperm incapable of swimming and result in infertility. And in either sex, since the true cilia are a prominent feature of the columnar epithelium of the respiratory tract, these individuals are prone to chronic respiratory infections because they have a decreased ability to move mucus out of the respiratory system and into the pharynx for swallowing.